On August 15, 1979, Francis Ford Coppola released his Academy Award-winning film, Apocalypse Now. This groundbreaking blockbuster was recognized as a landmark in film history. Its use of saturation, lighting, and music changed the way war films were produced and directed. Coppola, already famous for his film The Godfather, drew from many great literary sources to accomplish this. He referenced many great works, such as T.S. Eliot's poetry, Orson Welles' film Citizen Kane, and Joseph Conrad's mega-hit novella, Heart of Darkness.
This is the end, beautiful friend. This is the end, my only friend, the end of our elaborate plans, the end of everything that stands, the end.
Polish-born author Joseph Conrad, to many, represented the pinnacle of the modernist movement in writing. Popular from the time after the death of Victoria, but before the outbreak of the First World War. He, along with fellow authors James Joyce and Franz Kafka, wrote on subject matters pertaining mainly on the human animal and the psychology thereof.
Well, I think the important thing to understand when trying to interpret Heart of Darkness is to recognize that what Conrad wants to deal with was a preoccupation of his, and that is the question of depravity, evil that human beings are capable of. I think that the journey that Kurtz undertakes that he describes to his fellow sailors is really a journey into a quest for understanding of what human beings are capable of.
Ideas such as the internal struggle between good and evil and the very basis of identity were questioned. Heart of Darkness embodies this movement, using descriptive language and political incorrectness to thoroughly examine and interpret this on a psychological level. It is told as an actual story swapped between sailors.
I don't want to bother you much with what happened to me personally, he began showing in his remark the weakness of many tellers of tales who seem so often unaware of what their audience would best like to hear. Yet to understand the effect of it on me, you ought to know how I got out of there, what I saw, and how I went up that river to the place where I first met the poor chap.
This allows an audience to connect with the protagonist, Charles Marlowe, on a level almost unattainable to stories of former years. The connection formed with Marlowe brings the reader into the world of early 20th century Africa. We become his subjects. We know what he wants us to know. We see what he wants us to see, and what we see is a world torn by imperialism and greed. Marlowe, an agent of a British ivory company, begins accustomed to the decadence and corruption of his employers. The mistreatment of the native Africans and lack of tolerance of their agents' actions do not faze him.
Going up that river was like traveling back to the earliest beginnings of the world, when vegetation rioted on the earth, and the big trees were kings.
What's powerful about the story is that, both stories, is that they're a journey. And like many quest stories, they're a journey of self-discovery. And what's important is what Marlowe learns and what Willard learns. And if they weren't able to learn and discover this aspect, this very, very pessimistic view of human nature that it seems that both Coppola and Conrad are trying to advance, then it wouldn't have the interest and it wouldn't have the impact that both stories do. Apocalypse Now recognized as a classic film and Heart of Darkness recognized as a classic short novel. So I think that the choices made by Conrad and how Coppola chose to adapt Conrad's idea were necessary for it to be a story of a journey, a literal quest, and then a metaphorical quest for self-discovery, the discovery being the nature of the weakness and possible depravity in human beings.
Through this, we begin to consider the subject of evil. In this tale, evil has a name. Mr. Kurtz.
You're an errand boy. Sent by grocery clerks. To collect a bill.
I feel he's portrayed, initially, at least in terms of the progression of the film, initially he's, he starts out as this, this mysterious kind of, because you don't know who the person is, the character is, until later in the film. But he starts out, before you actually see the character, he's this rogue, traitor, kind of insane, made himself this deity for this village. And but when you actually, when Martin Sheen's character actually finally makes it to his compound and you start learning more about Kurtz, it's like his ideas aren't so, his ideas on war and society, they don't seem so crazy, but you still kind of get this feeling that there's not.
Kurtz is one who went mad, sick with fever and his environment. Because of superior technology, the local tribes revere him as a demigod, and he slowly begins to believe this.
I looked at him, lost in astonishment. There he was before me, in motley, as though he had absconded from a troupe of mimes, enthusiastic, fabulous. His very existence was improbable and altogether bewildering.
I mean, what are they gonna say, man, when he's gone, huh? Because he dies, when it dies, man. When it dies, he dies. What are they gonna say about him? What are they gonna say? He was a kind man? He was a wise man? He had plans? He had wisdom? Bullshit, man! Am I gonna be the one that's gonna set them straight? Look at me, wrong! You.
But is Kurtz evil? He is seen killing, raping, acting as a false god, but is he the evil of the story?
Well, I don't necessarily see Kurtz as an antagonist. I think actually, if anything, Kurtz is a vehicle for Marlowe to discover uncomfortable truths about human nature. And there are many times in the story he refers to his obsession with Kurtz, he refers to his alliance with Kurtz, he refers to his obligation to Kurtz. And given what he was sent to do, and given the fact that Kurtz, the things he's doing, he has human heads, speared on that are displayed outside his quarters. All those things would seem to indicate that he should fear, or at the very least, be extremely horrified and disgusted with Kurtz's behavior. But in fact, he seems to appreciate Kurtz in an interesting way, and I think it's because the reality of Kurtz allows him to see inside his own heart and to see what he can be capable of. And of course, that knowledge is empowering, because he then can make sure that he is not in a similar situation, doing things that demonstrate that lack of self-control, that lack of self-discipline, and that lack of respect for other human beings.
So if Kurtz is not an evil character of fear, but a being of our own subconscious, we must reconsider what is evil in our world. The audience is forced to face their own inner evil and begin to question their own morality. If this false god is not our personal Satan, who is? These forced second thoughts merely deepen as the character dies, and we realize he is just as human as any of us.
I thought his memory was like the other memories of the dead that accumulate in every man's life, a vague impress on the brain of shadows that had fallen on it in their swift and final passage. But before the high and ponderous door, between the tall houses of a street as still and decorous as a well-kept sepulchre, I had a vision of him on the stretcher, opening his mouth voraciously as if to devour all the earth with all its mankind.
On this journey, he discovers that what happened to Kurtz, and Kurtz's choices, given his circumstances, given his temptations, were choices that all human beings are capable of making, given human weakness. So the heart of darkness that he was exploring in the title was really, I would probably say, could be put as the darkness in everyone's or all of our hearts.
We must accept that in the dark recesses of our minds, there is this primal maliciousness. This is the very basis of the book, and the audience is left with a pessimistic view of themselves. Yet, this cannot be fixed. All can be wicked. There is no other reality.
Think you're out of tune.
Shut up.
Being recorded.
Say it again. I'm allowed to use what?
You're allowed to use the flip, but not this camera. But
this camera is
mine.
Okay. Just wanted to get that face on there because it's good face.
He was a wise man. He had plans. He had wisdom. Bullshit, man.
Yeah. You expect me to turn on the camera and press record and make a making of video.
Oh my gosh, where am I?
My friend, may I have my camera back? Nah. Mariah, give me the camera. Give me the camera. Give me the camera back.
I'm gonna kill you.
Yeah, don't. Care of this on film.
No, there's someone I know who thinks that Liam Neeson is God.
Liam Neeson, no. Morgan Freeman, maybe. Even from this distance, I can get so close I can look inside Luke's pores. I love this. Maybe. Give me the camera.
Yeah. Well, think about it. Liam Neeson played Aslan. And he played the King of the Gods.
Okay.
Morgan Freeman played
people.
God.
Following
you. Stay on subject.
And we everybody need
to stand task. Give me the camera.
Hey, you guys, have some manners and courtesy and sit down and be quiet.